from today is from Acts 28, verses 11 to 15. After 3 months, we put out to sea in a ship that was wintered in the island. It was an Alexandrian ship with the figurehead of the twin gods Castor and Pollux. We put it in Syracuse and stayed there for 3 days. From there, we set sail and arrived in Rhegium. The next day, the south wind came up, and the following day, we reached Puteoli. There, we found some brothers and sisters who invited us to spend a week with them, and so we came to Rome. The brothers and sisters there had heard that we were coming, and they traveled as far as the Forum Appius and the Three Taverns to meet us. And at the sight of these people, Paul thanked God and was encouraged. This is the reading of the word. You may be seated.
Good morning. So glad to be here. Sorry, I didn't come last week. I had issues with my foot. You guys can approach me after, and it's a long story. But we're good. We're good. Thank you all for your prayers. Raylani is healthy and growing and strong. Rizal is recovering well. And so we just want to thank you for your prayers and your support. We won't be bringing Raylani at least for the next 2 months. So if you guys want to visit, you can let me know, and you're more than welcome to come visit. I just wanted to just say that. So as Pastor TJ mentioned earlier that I am doing the end of the series on the book of Acts, Truth Matters, Share the Truth, Change the World. And so beginning next week, we're going to be doing our series, just giving you a glimpse of it, called Extraordinary. We're going to hear about ordinary people who were made extraordinary. So we will prepare ourselves for that. But let's just finish this series on the book of Acts first. So we have been on the book of Acts for at least like 20 weeks now. Pretty crazy, right? But although we are on the last chapter and that we are at the end of this series, I want all of you guys to take a look at your four W's. What does it say? It says, be faithful to the end. That is the title of today's sermon. Be faithful to the end. Because you see, the book of Acts is not about Paul. It's not about Peter. It's not about Barnabas. It's not about the disciples who were in the upper room who suddenly started speaking other nations' language. It is all about continuing the work of our Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit through his people. Because if we look at Acts 1, after Jesus has appeared before the disciples, proving that he is alive, right, and he is alive and well today, spent time with them for 40 days. And just right before he was going to ascend to heaven, he said this in Acts 1:8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and what? And to the ends of the earth. So today, although we are in the last book of Acts, the last chapter of this book, today we are the continued chapter. So my question to you is, just because you're following Jesus today, does that guarantee that you'll be following Jesus tomorrow, 5 years from now, 50 years from now? No, it does not guarantee that. Because we are all in a journey. And I want to encourage you all, to exhort you all, to be faithful to the end. You know, C.S. Lewis quoted, right? You can't go back and change the beginning, but you can start where you are and change the ending. And I just saw someone rocking a pretty dope hoodie with this quote from Oscar Wilde. Every saint has a past, and every sinner has a future. So what you do today will impact how you end. And will you be faithful to the end? So what are the things we must do to be faithful to the end? I want to share with you five truths. That's a lot, right? So we got to go right through this. That the Bible teaches in Acts 28 on being faithful to the end. And the first thing we must do is trust God. We must trust God. We take a look at the beginning of Acts 28, right? They were washed ashore in an island called Malta, where they were greeted by the islanders, thankfully. They were welcome and had built a fire for them because, you know, they were soaking wet from the shipwreck and it was raining cold. Mind you, they had just come from the nor'easter storm that was like a never-ending battle with the storm. But as they were building the fire, Paul, always finding ways to be of service, gathered a pile of brushwood for the fire when suddenly, a viper just wrapped around his arm, jumped up and wrapped around his arm. So you can see that in here, right, in 28 verse 3. Paul gathered a pile of brushwood, and as he put it on the fire, a viper, driven out by the heat, fastened itself on his hand. But what was Paul's reaction? Paul was unfazed. Paul was not bothered. What did he do? And we see that in verse 5. But Paul shook the snake off into the fire and suffered no ill effect. I don't know about you guys, but if a viper wrapped his arms around me, I would definitely not be doing what Paul just did. I would be bringing out, I'm like, throw it out or whatever, and then hopefully it didn't bite me, and if it bite me, that's it. I'm just gonna just go on my knees, just pray to God, and just be like, I'm ready to meet you, you know? But Paul didn't do that. Why was he unfazed, and why was he not bothered by the viper? Because if we look earlier in Acts 27, during the never-ending battle with the storm, we see in verses 23 and 24, he said, last night, an angel of God, to whom I belong and whom I serve, stood beside me and said, do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar. And where were they? They were not in Rome yet. They were in Malta. And then we go even further back, all the way back to Acts 23:11, right? When Paul's life was in danger to the point where the commander was afraid Paul would be torn into pieces by the Pharisees and the Sadducees. But it says here, take courage. As you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must also testify in Rome. So what I'm trying to say is that Paul trusted God that somehow he was going to make it to Rome. He was going to make it to Rome. So he knew he was going to be protected. He knew that no harm would come to him, at least until he had made it to Rome. And then you can see after that, it took him a while to go to Rome. It was God's promise to Paul. And whether we know that God is what? The same yesterday, today, and forever. God keeps his promise. So I want to encourage you, what are some of God's promises, right? John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. That's a promise. For those that believe, that is a promise. 2 Corinthians 4:14, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. That is God's promise for those who believe. What are some other promises? Isaiah 41:10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Deuteronomy 31:8. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. So do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. That is what I feel and believe that Paul was feeling at that moment, because he was focusing on the promise that God had. He was trusting God to keep his promise. And these are just two of the promises, eternal life and that he's always with you. That's just two of the promises of the many promises that God has for those who are his insiders, for those that believe, for those that are in his family. But this is also a gift that is given to anyone and everyone. You just have to receive it. That is the promise of God. So right now, if you feel like you have a viper wrapped around your arm, figuratively speaking, or you're in a never-ending storm, I encourage you with this. Trust God. Trust God. But what does it mean to trust God? Whatever you are going through, whether good or bad, the way you respond, the way you react, the way you act, what you choose to do it in a way that will honor God. That's what it means to trust God. That whatever you do, you are going to see God and respond in the way that God wants you to respond. Because why? Look at this verse. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Acknowledging God in all your ways is what it means to trust God. Acknowledging God in all your ways. Every decision you make is not your own, because you just need to ask God, what is it that you want me to learn? What is it that you want me to do? What is it that you want me to do that is according to your word and according to your will? Make sure that it's not anyone else's advice, not your own advice, but it is God through his word. So the first thing we must do to be faithful to the end is to trust God. The next thing is to journey together. Let's look at Acts 28, our text, 15, right? It says, after 3 months, we put out to sea in the ship that had wintered in the island. It was an Alexandrian ship with the figurehead of the twin gods, Castor and Pollux. We put in at Syracuse and stayed there 3 days. From there, we set sail and arrived at Rhegium. The next day, the south wind came up. On the following day, we reached Puteoli. There we found some brothers and sisters who invited us to spend a week with them, and so we came to Rome. The brothers and sisters there had heard that we were coming, and they traveled as far as the Forum of Appius and the three taverns to meet us. At the sight of these people, Paul thanked God and was encouraged. So when he got to Rome, which Paul had never been there before, but always wanted to go, but now he's there as a prisoner, to his surprise, met brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ there. The work was already being done in Rome. And Paul was already, you know, he was ready to go and share the gospel, but yet, to his surprise, it has already reached there. And what's amazing is that they had come from, you know, the Forum of Appius and the Three Taverns just to meet Paul. So these places, from where Paul was, where they went to meet him, one of them is at least 33 miles away, and the other is 42 miles away. Now by car, that's still pretty far. But mind you, they did not have cars back then. Whether it was by animal or by foot, that's still pretty far distant. But can you just imagine? What does this do? It encouraged Paul. Now, Paul may look like a man who's strong enough to stand through all the beating that he took, to stand through all the malice that he took, to stand through all the imprisonment that he took, right? But he still get discouraged. He is still a human being, just like you and I. We all get discouraged, right? And that's why we must journey together. That is what us pastors, Pastor Doty, Pastor TJ, Pastor AJ, and myself have been preaching to you and teaching to you throughout this whole series, that it is discipleship. Discipling each other to serve each other so that you can encourage each other. There are two mindsets when it comes to serving. Here's one of it. One is, how do I use people and their resources to serve me and my own interests, right? And the second is this, how do I give my life and my resource to serve others? Can you guess which one is biblical? And if you can't tell the difference, then have you been asleep for the past 20 weeks that we've been preaching? Biblical is, how do I give my life and my resource to serve others? More importantly, how do I give my life and my resource to serve my God? Journey together. Discipleship is one of the main keys to being faithful to the end. We've heard of testimonies throughout our whole series in the book of Acts, and I know that some of you may even have experienced the encouragement that you have gotten through discipleship. I encourage you to continue. And if you are not connected to a discipleship group, let's get you connected to one right away. Because nothing beats spending time together, learning about the Word of God, praying for each other, and encouraging each other to grow in the truth that matters most. Hebrews 10:24-25 says, and let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. But notice this though. Paul thanked God. He didn't thank the people that met him. He thanked God because it was all by the grace of God that his word has reached Rome before Paul has even made it there. And what's crazier is that the one purpose of that is so that Paul may be encouraged to stand trial before Caesar. He thanked God because it is God who changed the mindset of the people from being selfish to selfless. We don't do that on our own accord. It is only through the Holy Spirit are we transformed. It is through the Holy Spirit are we changed, and we change our mindset. Because I guarantee you, me growing up before I fully committed my life to Christ, my mindset was that. How can I use people and their resources to help me and, you know, to grow me and to benefit from that? And I tell you, man, it's crazy how God has changed me. It's crazy how God has changed people that are here in QBC. So we know that to be faithful to the end, we must trust God and journey together. Another thing we must do to be faithful to the end is to, I know not a lot of people like to hear this, but expect to struggle. Expect to struggle. All right, let's look at Acts 16 to 20. When we got to Rome, Paul was allowed to live by himself with a soldier to guard him. 3 days later, he called together the local Jewish leaders. When they had assembled, Paul said to them, "My brothers, although I have done nothing against our people or against the customs of our ancestors, I was arrested in Jerusalem and handed over to the Romans. They examined me and wanted to release me. Because I was not guilty of any crime deserving death. The Jews objected, so I was compelled to make an appeal to Caesar. I certainly did not intend to bring any charge against my own people." Verse 20, "For this reason, I have asked to see you and talk with you. It is because of the hope of Israel that I am bound with these chains." Paul, you know, I've always wanted to visit Rome because of all the history and the beauty of it, you know. Paul, too, I'm pretty sure he wanted to do that. And especially to be able to go to the synagogue and to go to the, to preach gospel. But he, what was he? He was there as a prisoner. He was there as a prisoner, not being able to enjoy the beauty of Rome, not being able to, you know, have that freedom as he should have for being an innocent man. When we think of the life of Paul and what he went through, we too should expect to struggle just as he did. I know, again, this is not what you all want to hear, but it's true. It's true. Just because we become a believer and a follower of the one true God who can make the impossible possible, that doesn't mean our life is going to be dandy and sweet. No, it does not. We're not going to become, you know, very rich and just be able to live an easy, sweet life right at the moment we accept Jesus. Because one, we are called to carry our cross. Pastor AJ reminds us time and time again, right? If you aren't struggling, right, then you should evaluate to see if you are being faithful to God. Because Satan doesn't really bother you if you are not a threat to him. But if you become a threat to him, oh, the storm starts to come. But have hope, because if we aren't struggling, then the earlier 2 points that I just said would be pointless. It would be pointless. Our struggle brings the opportunity to trust God, to remind us to trust in God, and it brings opportunity for us to be able to, what, encourage each other and lift each other up. Otherwise, why would you be here? Why would I be here if I was perfect? No, we aren't. There is something that everyone struggles with, whether it's mental, whether it's emotional, whether it's physical. I know one thing, if they don't struggle in any of those, we all struggle with the spiritual life, whether we know it or not. We all struggle. So expect to struggle. When you expect to expect it, right, you are able to be faithful to the end. So far, we know that to be faithful again to the end, we must trust God, journey together, expect to struggle. The next thing is that we must witness faithfully. We must witness faithfully. Look at 21 to 24. They replied, "We have not received the letters from Judea concerning you, and none of our people who had come from there has reported or said anything bad about you. But we want to hear what your views are, for we know that people everywhere are talking against this sect." They arranged to meet Paul on a certain day and came in an even large number to the place where he was staying. He witnessed to them from morning till evening, explaining about the kingdom of God and from the law of Moses and from the prophets. He tried to persuade them about Jesus. Some were convinced by what he said, but others would not believe. They were curious. This situation that Paul had been in, you know, for all the way from Jerusalem, all the way to Rome, all this thing that built up, they were curious at what Paul had to say to them. And, you know, that is where there was an opportunity for Paul to share the truth that matters. Church, this is also what the whole series on the book of Acts is also about. That we are to be a faithful witness, testifying about the grace of God by what Jesus Christ had done for us. Are we witnessing in our homes daily, to our neighbors, in our workplace, in this church? The gospel that is for everyone of all race and all age. Are we witnessing faithfully? But here's a quick reminder when it comes to witnessing. Let's look at verse 24. So some were convinced by what he said, but others would not believe. And as I have always said, it is not our job to make people believe and do the saving. However, it is our job to witness faithfully. That is how we become faithful to the end. So again, so far, to be faithful to the end, we need to trust God, journey together, expect to struggle, we need to witness faithfully, and last but not least, we need to fix your eyes on Jesus. For the 2 years Paul stayed in Rome in a home that was rented, and he welcomed all who came to see him. What did he do? He proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. He continued to encourage people to fix their eyes on Jesus. You know, I had a friend who went to church. And for a few years, you know, there was growth, there was stuff going on. But then there was one thing that this person kind of started to lose focus on fixing their eyes on Jesus. This person approached me and was like, you know, I always see my family. Like, this is their immediate family and cousin. They're always out drinking. They look like they're having so much fun. And sometimes I just want to do that. And so person started to lose focus and not fixing their eyes on Jesus, and unfortunately had left the church. So my prayer is that God will redeem this person and bring them back to church. Because it says in Hebrews 12, 1-3, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Each of us have our own individual race that we must face. Fixing our eyes on Jesus is the key to running and being and persevering in this race. The pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. As I mentioned earlier, we're just human beings. We all struggle. We all will be discouraged. Jesus Christ himself been through this, and he was victorious over all, even when he was put down to death as an innocent man, put down to death, yet he overcame. So don't look at me. Don't look at your pastors and your leaders. We struggle. We have a hard time. Look at to the ones that we look up to, and that's Jesus Christ. That allows us to continue to serve God the same way Paul continued to serve God. Because he met Jesus Christ. Mind you, remember, Paul was the one who persecuted all these Christians, killing these Christians, imprisoning them. And when he encountered Jesus, he changed his life. And now all he wants to do is live for Jesus. He saw that he was raised from the dead, and he too wanted the same thing, to be raised from the dead. That is how we can be faithful to the end, when we continue to fix our eyes on Jesus. That is why we come to church. We don't come to church for our friends. We don't come to church for the music. We don't come to church for anything else but Jesus. So to be faithful to the end, we must trust God, journey together, expect to struggle, witness constantly or witness faithfully, and focus on Jesus. Focus on Jesus. That is the majority of what we've been teaching you in this series of the book of Acts, Truth Matters. Share the truth, change the world. And so now we will continue to journey together to fix our eyes on Jesus through the celebration of communion. But before that, we will pray. And before we pray, may I call on the pastors, the elders, and the deacons to come up front to be prepared to serve.
I'd like to call Pastor TJ and Pastor RJ. We just said that Roselle is not here and Raylani, but I'm sure they'll be happy also that we are celebrating them. We'd like to call Tracy and the three kids. I don't see them right now. Could somebody call them wherever they are? Jackie, can you please come? So Pastor TJ and Pastor RJ, we thank you for your service. The QBC family loves you for all your dedication and love to our to the whole family. We just have flowers for Roselle, for the wives. Tracy is should be here, and it's for Roselle. We had this beautiful and powerful message today, and just continue to bless in the Lord. And just a verse from 2 Corinthians 15:58. This is, I know, one of your favorite verses. It says, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor in the Lord is never in vain." So I just thank you for it. They're still not here, but we'd like to give a love gift for Pastor TJ and Pastor RJ, and Pastor Dodi also has a love gift, and we will give it to Charisse. Charisse wasn't able to come today, but we invited her to come. So thank you, Pastor TJ. And the senior has a love gift also. He'll call Nanay Edna to come. She would like to give you a love gift. And also the other ministries, the women's ministry, the men's ministry, and the young pro has a love gift also. They will hand it to you later. And this is from the seniors.
But I hope something inside is big.
Give it to Charisse. Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay, so Tracy and the kids. Yeah. And we just want to say a prayer for the Oyes family and Judan family. We'd like to call Daddy Henry to say a prayer for.
At first, I want to say something about our pastors. These two young pastors are very good. Because even our senior pastor is not here, they work very hard. And we hope everybody will support them. We are, praise God, that you use all your power, your strength, to serve this church, to serve God, okay? God is good all the time. Yeah. Especially I can hear what you're preaching. This is very good for us. Especially you are young. You still have time. Not us. I love all of you. I will pray for you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this moment that we can give the good things back to you, and also what your servants, the world will not in vain. Because they're preaching your word, they're teaching us, they help us and build this church for you, Father. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your mercy. I pray that you will give them the good future, and everything will be fine for this church. In Jesus' name, I pray all these things. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Hello. Oh, yeah. Just want to thank you all. You know, I was telling him, you guys finally got us. Surprise. But we do want to thank you all for your encouragement, especially for me. It's what gets me going to see how you guys are growing in the Lord and loving the Lord and just seeing how you got learning to serve God. It just brings joy to my heart. And then that's what allows me to continue what God has called me to do. So I just thank you all for being a part of God's kingdom and his, his family. So thank you.
Thank you, QBC, for being part of our lives. You know, this year would be my seventh year here with QBC as a family. And when I look back at those years since 2013, it was just me and Tracy back then. But I guess you prayed for us so that we multiply. That's the reason why you have all these three little children. But thank you. Thank you because you've supported us. To those of you who have, wisdom in parenting, you have given us your advice. And to those of you who are going to be parents soon, the wisdom that was passed on to us is the same wisdom that we can pass on to you. And so, like our preaching today, I'm glad that it was mentioned that we all struggle, all of us struggle. And then the good thing about it is that we struggle together. And so the burden is not that heavy anymore, because you and I carry each other's burden, and the Lord shall accomplish his work. There may be times that you look at us and we may fail you, but we point you to the one who never fails. Jesus never fails, the author and perfecter, the finisher of our faith. So as you look to us, we point you to him. And I hope that as other people look to you, your lives will be pointing to the only one who matters, that is Jesus Christ. So thank you, QBC, and in behalf of Pastor Dodie and his family as well, I'm sure they're very appreciative of the time that you have given them or allowed them to minister to Celine and their family. And we hope that they'll come back here safely soon. So thank you again, and we praise God for making all of these things happen. To him be all the glory.